Doing that right now. And yeah, happy to have your questions, answers, remarks, comments in the LinkedIn Live event. I just already posted in there. Yeah, happy to have your likes, your cheers on that when you like it. And yeah, when we have finished the recording, we will, for all of you who have registered to the event, we'll send a notification to that so that, yeah, in all contemplatancy, you can watch the recording and, yeah, enjoy the session again. Or, you know, if you haven't been able to make it to the live event, look at the recording. Also, there we would be happy then to have your feedback. Yeah, so what are we talking about today? Today, we are talking about how to protect against insider threats. And yeah, our guest today is Thomas Neudenberger from bioLock. Quickly introduce myself. I'm Marco Hammel from NoMonkey. And yeah, very pleased to have you, Thomas. Just need to check if we can also make you visible on the live stream. I think we cannot see you right now, but that should be just a matter of some small adjustments. Let's see if that actually makes a difference. Okay. Yeah. Protecting against insider threats. So Thomas is from bioLock, and I have to admit, I could hardly imagine to have anybody fitting better into that topic than Thomas, dealing with it since, yeah, Thomas, as I know, more than 20 years. Thomas, how about giving some insights about you and bioLock? Maybe you introduce yourself and bioLock.
Absolutely. Thank you very much, Marco. My name is Thomas Neudenberger. I'm originally from Kiel, Germany, as you might be able to tell, but I've lived in the United States now for over 25 years. And basically, working for Realtime is also an old established SAP consulting company, now part of the Valantic group over in Germany. If there are some Germans here that might have seen this orange logo over the years. But 1986, our founders founded Realtime. They had a lot of SAP expertise, and you know how demanding customers are. In 2000, they came with this yellow sticky note and they said, hey, everybody's writing down this password, logging on with other IDs. Do you have any idea what we can do about this? And they said, yeah, our customer is Siemens. They just showed us this cool Siemens ID mouse with an Infineon fingerprint sensor. And so we took this device and we built a custom application inside SAP's ABAP code for true 2FA, two-factor authentication. Type on the password that everybody knows from the sticky note, but now put the finger on for true two-factor authentication to log on to SAP. We called it bioLock. It was first certified by SAP March 1st, 2002, a little over 21 years ago, so it can now legally drink in the United States. And I was put in charge the same year to run Realtime North America out of the World Trade Center in Tampa to basically spread the mission about this new technology around this world. Obviously, we were about 10, 15 years too early, but I've been hanging in there. We have been working very hard. And of course, over the years, things improved. The fingerprint sensors look a little bit more modern these days. But we've also integrated other technologies, such as Fujitsu Palm Vein, for example, smart cards, of course, and most important for pharma industry and healthcare, NYMI bands. I call it biometrics for gloves with life detection. But the key is not talking really about the biometrics. The key is talking about granular controls. The fact that we're not only protecting logging the front door, logging onto the system, but every mouse click inside the system. So it starts with all the sensitive transactions, and then obviously the buttons, the value, everything inside the system. And to easily visualize it, you all know the hotel, you get a key card, you come to your room, you log in. Well, everybody in the hotel has that card. So that's not very secure. Just like in SAP, everybody is over-permitted in the hotel. So what do we do at night? Well, we go in our room and we take that swinging door bar and we close it. And once this is closed, nobody can open that door anymore. So we overrode the existing SAP security or hotel security. And that's pretty much what we allow you to do with bioLock is place as many swinging door bars as you want inside your SAP system. Give it a number, 005 controls the bank application or an FF110. And now you control from the bioLock, how do you open that door bar? Who do you specifically invite? Does it take a second person, a third person, or even four people with MFA technology to approve higher value wire transfers? So it gives you total control, but more important, also accountability if you choose to use the biometrics so you know really what is going on inside your SAP system. So I've been doing this for 21 years. We've had a global partnership with Fujitsu. I've personally presented in 5 continents. We have customers in all continents. We have a lot of stories to tell, and I think this is what we want to talk about here today and share some knowledge with you.
Yeah, I think like to emphasize this, it's really about event-based re-authentication of the user inside the SAP system. So it's not just like what we presumably should all do in the meanwhile, even though like saying very often SAP technology is an exception when it comes to multi-factor authentication. So you find a lot of SAP customers who have like multi-factor authentication in place anywhere else but for SAP. So at least I see that quite often. But it's really about that after the initial authentication, or like as part of the initial authentication, but also after that on an event level, on a transactional level, basically, you can re-authenticate the user to have a higher level of trust or verification that the user conducting a certain transaction is the actual user that's supposed to do that, to kind of summarize it, correct?
Pretty much, yes. In fact, I just came back from Europe here last week, and I was actually annoyed how often we had to show our ID at the airport. It wasn't 3 times, it wasn't 4 times, it was 5 times or more. So they're going a little bit overboard with it now. But again, it is all about security. They really want to know who is entering that international flight these days.
Mm-hmm. All right. Yeah. So as I already said, Thomas can hardly imagine anybody who fits better into that topic than, you know, discussing it with you. A couple of remarks about what we, do as part of our training offering. So we will, for example, also discuss the value of course, of access control in general in an SAP environment to mitigate insider threats. So recommend our training with Wolfgang here. Wolfgang is also so more than 25 years in the SAP access control space from integrity consulting. But also when it comes to understanding the threats that are related to insiders, it can be a game changer to implement threat modeling as a concept in your SAP environment. And you know how to do that, how you can approach threat modeling for SAP, what are the the caveats and obstacles that you can have with that. Vasim, our head of advisory, who's our threat modeler, will give you a lot of insights into that. you know, aligned with all of our, a couple of other mitigating techniques and to check, you know, what's your maturity level here, or to enable, for example, your SOC to do insider threat event detection. And of course, also understanding your current identity and authorization posture, we can help you with that, and also compile it into quantifiable risk when we are applying the FAIR methodology in your SAP environment. Yeah, but coming back to the to the discussion with you, Thomas, you know, we have some agenda for the next presumably 15 to 20 minutes. Which is, when it comes to SAP, very often insider threats are one by one considered to be fraud. So I would like to learn with you, what other insider threats do we should consider when it comes to SAP environments. And yeah, then we're continuing discussing strengths and limitations of certain mitigation approaches when it comes to insider threats. And also, you know, telling the hard truth that most insider incidents are not getting caught. And yeah, by our experience as a result of that, giving some recommendations how you can stay on top of the game, you know, summarizing this, and happy then to have an open discussion with you on the LinkedIn Live event. Yeah, with like going right away from here, Thomas, what's the evolution from your experience, from what you've seen at your customers, where I just taking an educated guess, the early adopters, their main motivation was really to fight fraud in their SAP environment, right? So like the typical things such as finance fraud and so on. But how have things evolved in the past 20 years?
Well, that's a very good question. And no, the first adopters, every single one of them told us, yes, we are very proactive. We want to prevent fraud. And it turns out years later, after couples of beers, that every single one of them had significant internal fraud cases that were mostly not publicized. They were basically pushed under the carpet, handled internally, not even reported. And so they lost significant amount of money, and they were reacting when they brought in bioLock as what we thought were innovators. Just over the past 5, 6, 7 years, we feel that companies actually learning from the more publicized cases, react more proactively and understand that they need to do something before actually the event occurs, and not just after something bad happened.
All right. So that's also some news to me. So where many companies thought they are in a presumably good state when it comes to insider threats, even though they weren't, or like it has been just put under the carpet, because I think it's also inconvenient, isn't it? So the external threat actor, so you know, the hacker with the hoodie, so to say, that is a much better target to be angry about, rather than, let's say, the employee or colleague just right next to you conducting, for example, fraud as an insider threat.
Well, not only that, but you can publicly blame the hacker because he's on the other side of the world. Nobody goes out and say, hey, my director of finance just stole $60 million, which happened to one of our early adopters. And it was publicized very briefly, but only in Spanish, so never really translated into English, sadly. But no, they don't want to talk about it. It's like talking about cancer 20, 30 years ago, nobody wanted to admit they had cancer. And it's still a really big problem because obviously it has to do with bad press. It has to do with liability. The stock market goes down. They lose consumer confidence. So sometimes it is just easier to say, no, nothing happened here. It's all good.
Yeah, I compiled actually a small picture to describe because insider threats are not a specific topic to SAP technology, but as per my experience and also the war stories we wanna share, SAP technology is specifically interesting when it comes to insider threats. So I just call it like the treasure island of insider threat here, where all of what typically can be the motivation of an insider threat, from IP theft to data corruption, identity theft, finance fraud, transaction fraud, all of these kind of things, they compile into this, typically like the ERP or finance or HR system that can happen over there. And that's, very often that's SAP technology. Did I forget anything that you think important to mention?
You're correct. Obviously, when people combined all the legacy system and went to SAP, that's the reason for that, because they could do everything in one system, right? So typically, most of our customers run finance, they run HR, and that's why those are the most targets. But then they also have CRM and the warehouse and everything else where a lot of data is being moved. This is where we see a lot of controls are being put in place when very high level or very valuable things are being moved in warehouses, specifically in the pharma industry, but also in the banking industry, where they are moving far more valuable stuff than you think. But you mentioned it, and it's actually not on your list here, is HR. And that was our first customer in the US, was actually NASA, Brevard County, where an employee walked up to an unlocked station and locked at info type 167 in HR, which is health plans, to find out what embarrassing operation his coworker had. And after he found out, he spread it in the company. And you can imagine that bad press in the following lawsuit. So they went in and locked it down with bioLock, actually won an award for it back in 2003. And in 2005, SAP TV came and made a movie about that installation. So HR is a big deal, payments. But one thing that we see in the US, protection of executive pay, because none of the high level executives that make millions over here want their employees to find out how much they really make. So one of the big deals in HR.
Yeah. Yeah, I can't believe so. It's basically also the same in Germany, that also executives don't necessarily want to have their salary exposed for whatever reason. I don't know. But I think information theft is one part of the game. When it comes to these kind of motivations, for example, I remember a case where a company recognized actually by accident that an SAP basis administrator who put a logic bomb to the SAP system, actually supposed to be like deleting all of the database files by a daemon script we were about to run. They just caught him by accident because the day he was about to leave the company, He just entered the system again, the operating system, to check if the logic bomb is really going to work. And that was the only reason actually they caught them. Otherwise, it would have been deleted the database and the database backups. Drastic impact possibly. But disgruntled employees, former employees, they are certainly some of the most prominent threat actors when it comes to insider threat. Do you agree?
Absolutely. That's how I got started, was in 2002 with the story of Roger Duronio, who was the system admin at UBS Payne Webber over here in New Jersey. And he did the same thing, created the time bomb to shut down some servers after he was denied the $20,000 bonus or $30,000. And so he planted the time bomb, the system shut down, and cost $3 million just to get them up and running. They never estimated the actual damages. But later, the interesting part about that story was when he originally went to court, his lawyer used the Saudi defense. Some other dude did it. That's the typical defense used in America to O.J. Simpson walk based on it, because somebody else did it. Proof that it was my client or we walk. And originally Roger walked as well, until they found out that he actually put some put options on the stock of UBS Pay November and made a lot of money by the stock crashing. And then they found out that there was a little bit more intent and they could frame him on that, and he went to jail. But yes, setting on fire, but it's not actually, I'll get fired, you set me on fire. We see it a lot that not even bonuses are cut, the promised pay raises don't come through, companies laying off people and so on.
Which is a very good, transmission to the next motivation, which is certainly money. So you just also just explained the case where there's disgruntlement and there's greed as a motivation. But it can be just greed by itself, or you know, maybe just the personal necessity to have extra money. That can be a reason. I, for example, came across a scenario where at a bank in Switzerland, an external developer just introduced kind of like a covert channel that were sending the company's reporting data, so the reporting for the stock exchange, the quarterly reporting information, just 2 weeks before they actually have to be published via an email to that external developer. So as we figured it out at the time, the external developer was like long gone, you know, not working for the company anymore. Presumably since about 8 to 10 years, that covert channel has been working. And most likely that person did some decent insider trading with that information. Where the interesting part is here, you can say that's kind of a victimless crime, at least until, for example, in the US, the SEC finds out about something like that, right?
Yeah, that becomes really interesting. But I mean, IP theft and just things like selling customer lists, selling vendor lists is a big deal. My favorite one here in the US was back, I think it was in 06, a Coke product manager took a lot of new development, not the original Coca-Cola recipe, but some new ones. And he offered them for $1.5 million to Pepsi. Actually showed up with an Armani bag with everything in it, thinking he would get $1.5 million, and then was arrested by the FBI because Pepsi actually did the right thing and got the FBI involved and set up a sting. But normal companies don't do that. There's a lot of stuff for sale. This stuff happens all the time. In fact, you can buy SAP logon credentials right now on the dark web for pennies on the dollar.
Yeah, and that's a very good point you make. That is, I think, you know, the case I described is rather more of an exotic one, I believe, but which is something that happens in the masses is credential brokering of SAP credentials in the dark web, and I want to emphasize that that this I have seen a couple of times as part of forensics. Happened throughout employees of managed SAP service providers, where, you know, after they left the organization, they did some, you know, made some extra cash with selling the credentials of the different SAP customers they have worked for in the organization. And that is actually something which can have severe impact to your whole IT environment. And last but not least, we have just the employees, and that's also part of insider threats, who just don't care. right? So who are ignoring the security best practices in your organization. And I see that, you know, very often when there is a very loose personal connection between the employee and the organization. So when they are, you know, when they're not really part of the community that that an organization creates. So presumably saying when there is bad security culture, at least with some of the employees, and this really can set things on fire. Do you actually know of and of course like bioLock with this granular access control implementation is a mitigation measure, but are you aware of such cases at your customers?
Yeah, I mean every customer pretty much, right? Mm-hmm. It starts with the yellow sticky notes that are hanging in the cubicles, but then the bigger problem is that employees go on vacation and they hand their password over to their colleague and say, hey, make sure you clean out my inbox and do my work while I'm on the beach, because I don't want to come back to that big workload. And we have one customer was specifically stays in my mind because KPMG was doing the auditing, and then they found out that all the people that were supposed to be on vacation were logged onto the system, and then they hired some interns to really compare the logs, and they were like, oh my God, this is unbelievable. Everybody's logging in with everybody at any point of time. So they basically forced the customer to put bioLock in place for the SAP logon for all the employees, and nobody can log on to the system anymore unless they put their finger on the sensor. So for the first time, they can really make sure that only Marco logs on as Marco, which is pretty cool.
Well, yeah, at least let's say when the SAP system is also significantly good patched, and so there's no authentication bypass and things like that possible. But yeah, certainly that specifically considering that when we are talking in most cases about insider threats, whether the threat actors are not always, at least, or let's say not in the masses, are technically very versatile. However, I've also seen some examples where actually a business user, for example, made his way by, for example, doing password cracking, password hash cracking. But I kind of tried to summarize a little bit, the different threat actors that not all of them, but giving an overview about some of the threat actors you should take care of when trying to protect yourself against insider threats. Anybody missing or anything? Anybody you find also important to mention?
Well, I mean, you say nicely the greedy consultant. I don't know if you're talking about the SAP consultant that's coming into the house or the person that works for the company. We actually see a lot of people in high-level position committing the largest frauds. So it's the head of the accounting, the head of finance, people that work in finance, because they need to be in a position where nobody can challenge them, and they have enough power to cover everything up. So we have seen a lot of that. You say in the right bottom corner, the negligent user. I think what's missing here is what we call the clueless employee, because a lot of damages here, we're talking about the intent. These are people that actually want to make the company lose money for certain motivations. But we also have a lot of money going out due to clueless employees. And that is the guy that makes a wire transfer that's supposed to be $100, and he is angry and he hits the zero two more times, and suddenly a couple of grand are leaving the company. And there is no mechanism to reconfirm this, to say, hey, who are you? Are you really wanting to send out $10,000? And there are a lot of fun cases that I've seen over the years. Like when I presented in South Africa in 2018, the same week, a student was supposed to get the $10,000 student loans, and she got $1 million. And guess what? She went all over Africa partying until it was shut down. But that was a clueless employee, and that happens more than we think because there are no controls in place that eventually would make the employee responsible. They don't care. They don't pay attention. They just enter stuff and let it go, and it's done.
That's very good. Yeah. Totally agree. I just had to put the guy from Jurassic Park in here as the disgruntled admin because, like, you know, it's just Jurassic Park is on point here when you remember the movie. So what can we do about it? That's of course, you know, and what are currently organizations doing about it? But what are the limitations to that? And I would just go forward in regards to that. I think that many organizations want to put technology on the problem. So when it comes to insider threats, a lot of CISOs think that the first thing they should be doing is implementing a DLP solution, a data leakage prevention solution, or implementing GRC. While like both of these solutions, of course, they are addressing and mitigating some kind of threat scenarios when it comes to insider threats. But I think like the really most important thing and the most crucial thing that also makes insiders aware of the risk they are probably taking to themselves is to have like non-repudiation measures in place. Because this is really where I see the most often court cases when it comes to insider threats to fail because of plausible deniability, as you also already mentioned an example to that. So deniability is really, really a problem that organizations should be afraid of, while it is the way to go, or that is where an insider can get away with it. Where do you see actually that the limitations typically SAP customers face when it comes to denialability to make a court case a successful court case against insiders?
Well, I mean, this all leads back to the three different credentials, right? What we know, who we are, and what we have. And it all started here in the United States back in the early 2000s when Enron went down. And the CEO said, oh, I never looked at the balance sheet. Sorry, didn't know it was that bad. Well, a lot of companies and people lost their retirement, and then Sarbanes-Oxley Act was established for more accountability. And SAP back then was making a movie, a SOX movie for their SAP TV. And they called me and said, hey, can we talk about this? I said, yeah, I can tell you about this, but I'd rather send you to California to talk to Paul Foote, a Harvard educated professor who was teaching bioLock back in the classroom. And he was featured in an original SOX movie that was just put back on SAP TV, saying that without a technology like bioLock, without biometrics, there is always the possibility of deniability because you can't nail the actual people down. And that is what we still see today, is that in a worst case scenario, if something happens, they say, well, anybody could have used my password. Prove to me that I saw this, that I did this, that I'm responsible for that. So unless we have your camera on face, we cannot for sure say if you had a mask on, we don't know if it was you. And that's exactly what the problem that we're having with the deniability and passwords.
Yeah, so very good point. And it basically, when it comes to non-repudiation, it all comes down to having evidence, and evidence in the digital world we have by logs. And when we look at some of like a very recent report on insider threats, then what is really, really worrisome, because it also has increased over the years, is the average amount of days it takes organizations to contain an insider incident. And when we are looking at these numbers, and for example, the cloud admins and the SAP basis admins watching this now, remember what is actually your log retention period. For example, with Microsoft, where we currently have that issue that, or we already also had that issue with SolarWinds and so on. Many of the events that possibly have had happened are, you know, not understandable right now because the default log retention time is 90 days. So which means when you are when you are above that average of the 85 days for the containment of the incident to do forensics, it becomes very, very likely that you cannot create a chain of custody anymore because you just don't have the event data. And as you were saying, so you need strong access control and authentication methods, and you need to have the data created throughout these mechanisms, throughout these techniques, to be able to, first of all, understand that you had an insider incident, and then also creating a chain of custody. What are you aware of? Like the one of the larger things that I recognized is an insider incident that was recognized 5 years after the incident actually happened. So what's your high record number on that?
Well, I like what you're talking about here, but the bigger question is how long does it take to even discover the threat? Mm-hmm. And I have seen years and years and years, and my favorite one that I'll never forget is Sister Mary Krueper, a nun working at a Catholic elementary school in California. She supposedly stole over 10 years about $835,000. Probably much more and much longer. But the fun part is, how did they discover that she stole the money? She retired. Nobody ever noticed anything while she was working at the school, but she eventually got too old. She retired. Her replacement came in, looked at everything, said, "What the heck happened here?" And it all blew up. So my message to the CEOs ever since is like, you don't think you have fraud going on. Chances are you do. Chances are if the people keep it low level, it will never be discovered. But do you really want to wait until your CFOs retire to find out that some of them were committing fraud all along? So that is something that you need to watch out for is, do I want to wait for them to retire? Well, you can look at certain things, establish hotlines, but you can also look at people that never take vacations, because that is highly suspicious since they need to cover things up. And if they go on vacation, things might blow up, so they don't go. But that is the thing that I would pay attention to. But again, once the controls are in place, you don't have to worry about it too much.
I very much agree. And to kind of summarize, what are the possible controls, but also what are typically the threat actors that you should consider when it comes to protecting against insider threats. So like that's actually from the book Walling Out the Insiders, which is kind of like a standard book in that regards. On the left, when it really comes from the hiring process, introducing background checks, introducing like up to access control systems as protective or preventative measures. And also, of course, detective measures have their place in there. So to implement some sort of surveillance techniques, implementing capabilities when it comes to user and entity behavior analytics, they all have their point. Be conscious that they require operational effort. They, you know, require a continuous adjustment. And specifically here in Germany, we talked about this before, Thomas. People are often afraid of the wrong things when it comes, let's say, to surveillance techniques, where also an important part of that when you as an employee or in general as an insider in the organization, also for me personally as a consultant, it's very, very important for me to take care of that security measures are in place and working well, so that I've been using strong passwords and so on, because I don't want to be insulted for having done something that I didn't that I haven't done, and so it's also about protecting yourself as an employee to take care of security. I think Thomas, if you don't mind wrapping these things up with some final recommendations here, and also love to have your statements about it. And like from my personal point of view, it really breaks down that, you know, you need to have some level of security culture implemented and fostered in your organizations. Also, as I said, that people are understand it's important for them that they can protect themselves against false accusations. And certainly creating, continuously creating awareness, train the employees, because this is, you know, with the example of the disgruntled admin that I've mentioned, who wanted to have a time bomb implemented at his former employer, it was just due to the awareness of another administrator recognizing that something is wrong here. And when you foster a relationship with people, you are most likely the best one to understand if, for example, also somebody got blackmailed or something like that. So technical controls are important, but people are a very, very important line of defense here. And of course, Thomas, like non-repudiation is like really, really your thing. So having this implemented as part of your solid SAP security baseline, and on top of that with something like bioLock, I think that is really key. And like bioLock is really one of the solutions where you can say, like, how long does it take to implement bioLock in an SAP environment?
We have done it as fast as a couple of days. This is the one thing that people don't realize, is this is not a month and year operation, which is why a lot of companies actually opt to move the bioLock in before they even move the GRC in, because it generally takes a little bit longer, but at least they have some real protections in place before they then use it to re-authenticate SAP GRC later on. But it's installed via transports in our namespace, so you really don't need to do anything. Then the key is, how do I configure it? And here you can start with the logon, or you start with a few transactions and you work your way up. So it's basically one step at a time.
So, and there we see like strong authentication is typically a technical measure, which is, you know, certainly easier to implement. And, you know, when we're talking about a GSE project, we are talking about a project typically for a duration of over 2 years easily. Or also something like DLP, it really takes time to implement. Doesn't mean that there is no value out of doing that, but you want to have done something right now, right? And you don't want to wait for it to be in place in about 2 years. And I think that's also, I think it's a strong statement to somebody who thinks about committing and committing fraud or something like that, when they know they have to have their biometrics or generally their identity re-authenticated on the transaction where they want to commit the fraud, I believe, right?
Yeah, let me give you a quick visualization. Here in the United States, you know it from the movies, everybody has the garage in the house, right? And the electric garage door. And generally outside the garage door, you find a PIN pad. You type in a 4-digit PIN, the garage door opens. And of course the kids have the PIN. And after a week, all their friends have the PIN. And after a year, the whole neighborhood knows the PIN. So kind of a little bit over permitted. So a long time ago, I ripped out that pin pad. I used to have one, believe it or not, and put a biometric door lock in the front door. And that was the first good start, because now only my children and my wife who are enrolled can get in the house. But I also put that same biometric door lock in my home office here behind me. So only my wife and I can get into my home office. Nobody else will ever be able to get in. And I continue this. I have biometric door locks in my closets inside my office. So you need to put the finger on it, the lock opens. Now, tell me that this is not very fast and very convenient and far more secure than rolling that 3-digit or 4-digit number that everybody can figure out anyway. And that's exactly
certainly, yeah. Giving just a little point that this is very great until you have your finger. When you cut off your finger, then it can be rather annoying, I believe.
Well, you have 10 fingers, so they have to do a lot of cutting. And it's a myth that you can cut off the finger and it still works, because the sensors have life detection built in. So you need to have the finger attached to your body. And at this point, when the people are really, I've heard people asking a question, and if somebody goes to the physical violence, they would be much better off just put a gun to your head and say, put your finger on the sensor. They really don't need to chop off your finger.
So Thomas, this was really, really great. For all of our listeners, happy to have your questions right away. I already saw some in the chat. But first of all, it's important to let you know that we will have a small break of the Tackling SAP Security Together in August, but we will be back in September. So just follow the monkey and stay tuned, and then you will receive the next event invitation. And happy to see you then. And just also, if you wanna exchange, and because it's really about learning and getting better together, maybe you want to share. Of course, you don't need to name any names or companies or whatsoever, but what insider threats that you have come along with. Did we miss any interesting story that you might want to share with us? And in the meanwhile, I'm just starting with the first question. So that came along. So how would you rate the number, the amount of insider threats versus external threats based on your long year experience? Thomas, what is your impression on that?
I don't know if we can really put a number and say there's 80% versus 20 or 60 versus 40, but what we have seen in the past, the external threats, the hackers came in via the network, they accidentally got access, they looked around in the system, and they maybe deleted some files. The insider that had extensive knowledge of the system, so the director of finance that specifically went in, was able to create purchase orders, approve them, and then issue payments for it and cover it up afterwards, was able to cause far more damages. Now, in the recent years, we have seen that change tremendously, because the hackers got much smarter. They figured out, We're not only disgruntled IT experts that are not getting paid, that are causing chaos. We actually can use our knowledge to make money, which is why we're seeing ransomware attacks, why we're seeing hackers coming into the financial system, downloading data, or even issuing wire transfers, because they can simply go to YouTube and say, teach me how to do a wire transfer out of SAP. And they get the full instructions. And then they can go online and say, how do I follow certain procedures at a certain company? And chances are they get the instructions directly for the company. So I can't tell you what is the bigger threat. I can tell you that we are protecting against insider as well as hackers as well, because once a payment is protected and only Marco is invited, with their MFA credentials, I can guarantee you that no insider or external hacker can access that function. But in generally, we don't know and we will never find out. But I think generally the damages, the higher damages are still done by the internal employees from what we have seen.
Yeah, so I would even say that for most external driven incidents, to like a very large percentage of them, an insider incident is like part of the whole kill chain somewhere. Like being it in terms of that that a negligent employee fell for phishing or something like that, or you know, that there were some kind of scenario where most of the time an insider did not do a diligent job implementing security measures. And so I think still for like the vast majority, 90% plus, even though there's an external threat actor taking advantage of that, it has like the root cause coming from an insider incident. All right, let's see what else do we have over here. I don't know what Wazim is talking about, how you stop nuns from committing fraud. Do nuns commit fraud?
Yes, that's yep. The one I was talking about, Mary.
Yeah, the one you were talking about. Yeah, I think that there's kind of the problem of the trust that is tied to the role, right? Somehow.
It's the good old German saying, Vertrauen ist gut, Kontrolle ist besser. Trust, yeah. But verify, right? And in this case, who wouldn't trust a non, right? That's the one problem we have. But I have a slide in my presentation that says, just because you're going bowling with them doesn't mean you need to trust them when it comes to fraud, right? And one of the biggest stories, there's actually a Netflix movie about it, Rita Cronwell, the queen of all horses, stealing double-digit millions from a little city of Dixon, Illinois, where she was an accountant. No street was ever fixed because every money that came in, she took out. And she eventually had a horse farm with 100 horses, a $2 million RV, going to events and basically telling everybody in the city that her family was really rich and invested in the stock market, and she just worked as an accountant to give back to the city. And everybody trusted her. So this is, I think, the main message is do not trust anybody. Everybody is a suspect, and unless they're ruled out or they're protected, well, you don't know what's really going on.
Yeah. And I think this is like a very good last word, specifically in a security information broadcast, as we do. You never know what's going on. And in that sense, Thomas, thank you very much for joining the conversation here and with the people on LinkedIn. And looking forward to do that again. It was really fun. And wish you a great Friday and hopefully a good weekend rather sooner than later.
Absolutely. Well, we'll see you in September for sure. This was fun as always. And if there are any questions, most of me know me on LinkedIn. If not, feel free to connect and we'll chat. I appreciate everybody's time.
All right. Thanks, everybody. And when you haven't done so, enjoy your summer vacation. Stay tuned. We will be back with tackling SAP security together. All right. Stream is over. Okay. Yeah, Thomas, how was it for you?
Oh, great. I love it. Enjoyed it. I just pulled out the picture and I was trying to figure out a way to show it, but maybe we'll do it next time because I Googled it after we were talking about my secret city here earlier. There's actually a billboard, and I took a picture of it, and there's a local museum, of course. This is a big deal here, right? Oak Ridge, Tennessee. And there was a billboard, a real truck-sized billboard on top of a mountain.